So we discussed the early Jaina theory of knowledge and also how it assumed more sophisticated form of the theory of pramanas. In today's talk, we will discuss the sophisticated Jaina theory of pramanas. After the 8th century, Jaina philosopher Akalanka, we have the sophisticated theory which was generally accepted by all the later Jaina philosophers, Jaina logicians. The following classification of pramanas was accepted according to it. I have already showed it on the board. So first, pramana is classified into two major kinds, pratyaksha and paroksha. Then pratyaksha is classified into two kinds, paramarthika pratyaksha and samvyavaharika pratyaksha. Paramarthika pratyaksha is classified into avadhi, manapariyaya and kevala. We have already seen that in the early Jaina epistemology, there was the classification of knowledge where avadhi, manapariyaya and kevala were included. Then samvyavaharika pratyaksha, that is what we can call ordinary perception, and that was classified into four kinds, avagraha, iha, avaya and dharana. Then paroksha pramana was classified into five kinds, smriti, pratyabhidnya, tarka, anumana and agama. So let us begin with paramarthika pratyaksha. Jainas divide it into two kinds, vikala and sakala, that is incomplete perception and complete perception. Kevala jnana is supposed to be complete, that is sakala, because it has everything as its object. Avadhi jnana and manapariyaya jnana, sometimes it is called manapariyava jnana, they are incomplete because their objects are limited. Avadhi jnana is translated as clairvoyance. It has tangible things, of course, remote, transcendent, remote tangible things, rupi dravyas as its object. And manapariyaya jnana is translated as telepathy. It has mental states of others as its objects. According to Jainas, clairvoyance and telepathy can be achieved by a spiritual practitioner when the respective jnanavaraniya karma are destroyed or subsided. Now, we have already talked about jnanavarani, different types of karmas which obscure the capacities of the jiva. So one of them is jnanavaraniya karma, which obscures the capacity of jiva for knowing everything. Jiva by in its essence has capacity to know everything, but that capacity is obscured by jnanavaraniya karma. Now this jnanavaraniya karma is divided into various kinds depending upon different types of jnana. So with respect to every type of jnana, there is a different type of jnanavaraniya karma. So by destruction of that particular type of jnanavaraniya karma, jiva will have particular type of knowledge. So with reference to avadhi, there is avadhi jnanavaraniya karma. With respect to manapariyaya jnana, there is manapariyaya jnanavaraniya karma. So by destruction or subsidence, sometimes karma is only suppressed temporarily and not destroyed completely, but that also can cause knowledge. So when the respective jnanavaraniya karmas are destroyed or subsided, then one can have clairvoyance or telepathy, and that destruction or subsidence is possible through spiritual practice. But in the case of clairvoyance, it can be inborn also. So it does not necessarily presuppose spiritual practice. For example, beings in Naraka and Swarga, according to Jainas, have capacity for clairvoyance by birth. So when a jiva is born in a particular Swarga or Naraka, then it has that inborn capacity. That is because those beings do not have physical sense organs, so they can perceive things by extrasensory perception only. But telepathy, according to Jainas, can be achieved through spiritual progress only. The idea that through penance, meditation and such spiritual practices one can attain supernormal knowledge was common to many systems of Indian philosophy. In Buddhism, it was called Yogijnana and was included in Pratyaksha Pramana. Patanjali in Yoga Sutra described various types of supernormal knowledges as direct knowledges arising from integrated meditation, that is Sanyama. So Patanjali developed this concept of Sanyama in the third chapter of Yoga Sutra, and there he describes how different types of supernormal capacities for knowledge are possible through Sanyama. In Nyaya, it was included under Alaukika Pratyaksha. One of the major differences between Nyaya and other systems was that for other systems, the mind or soul through yogic practice attains power to know remote objects and other minds without establishing contact with them. So it is just a result of the special power, but no contact is necessary. Nyaya, on the other hand, insisted on contact theory of perception, that is Sannikarsha theory of perception. The theory was extended to supernormal perception by postulating the extraordinary contact called Yoga Lakshana Pratyasakti. The highest form of supernormal knowledge is omniscience. It is called Sakala Paramarthika Pratyaksha, that is complete perception in true sense of the term, in the Jaina epistemological scheme. In Jainism, omniscience is called Kevala Jnana. It is a mark of liberated jiva. We have seen that according to Jainism, any knowledge is possible due to destruction or subsidence of a particular type of Jnanavaraniya karma. But Kevala Jnana is possible when all types of Jnanavaraniya karma are fully destroyed. We have seen in the last talk that Jaina philosophers hold the doctrine of Sarvajnata, which means knowledge of everything in the literal sense of the term. According to it, the omniscient soul knows all objects, past, present and future, simultaneously. I suggested in the last talk that this doctrine is riddled with problems. So I will not go into details of that. This is a brief story of the Jaina view of Paramarthika Pratyaksha. In my humble opinion, it can be appreciated as an expression of religious belief of the Jainas rather than a rational epistemological exercise. In fact, the belief in superhuman knowledge is a common belief shared by many systems of Indian philosophy. There are two important exceptions, Purva Mimamsa and Charvaka. Without going into the controversy, let us move to the other type of Pratyaksha, namely Samyavaharika Pratyaksha. Ordinary perception, or what is called Samyavaharika Pratyaksha by Jainas, is not a cognitive episode occurring in one moment, but it is a process which takes 4 or 5 steps. It is a process of judgmental cognitions or determinate cognitions. But before this process of judgmental cognitions, non-judgmental awareness takes place, which is called darshana, intuition, and is distinguished from jnana. So initially one has just awareness of an object without determining what it is. That awareness they call darshana, seeing. And it is regarded as indeterminate and it is distinguished from jnana. So they distinguish between darshana and jnana. The distinction between non-judgmental and judgmental awareness is common to the systems we have studied so far, Nyaya, Buddhism and Jainism. However, their status differs from system to system. The following table will show how the two kinds of awareness have diverse status in the three systems, namely Nyaya, Buddhism and Jainism. So, non-judgmental awareness. In Nyaya, that is, it is called Nirvikalpaka Pratyaksha. That Nirvikalpaka Pratyaksha itself cannot be directly known according to Nayayikas, but its occurrence can be inferred. It is not regarded as Praman, or rather, it is not regarded as Prama, that should be the correct word there. Then, in Buddhism, what is the status of non-judgmental awareness? It is directly known. When one has non-judgmental awareness, one is at the same time aware that one has that type of awareness. It is regarded as pratyaksha pramana. In Jainism, non-judgmental awareness is called seeing, intuition, darshana, but it is not knowledge, jnana. Now, in the case of judgmental awareness, that is what is called, what can be called savikalpaka jnana or vikalpa, according to Nyaya, it can be directly known. That is, it is known through what is called anuvyavasaya. One has judgmental cognition, one perceives a pot as pot. That is, it will be a kind of judgmental cognition. And then at the next moment, one is aware that one is perceiving the pot. So that second moment awareness is called anuvyavasaya, which is also supposed to be perceptual cognition, that is direct knowledge, which the Atman has through manas. So judgmental awareness can be directly known. It is regarded as pramana, or rather prama, it should be, judgmental awareness will be regarded as prama in the sophisticated Nyaya system. Then, in Buddhism, judgmental awareness is not regarded as pramana at all. And in Jainism, again, judgmental awareness is regarded as pramana, and according to them also, it is directly known, but it is directly known at the same time. So the difference between Nyaya and Jainism will be that according to Nyaya, the perceptual awareness is cognized at the next moment by what is called anuvyavasaya. According to Jainism, perceptual cognition is directly known at the same time because the knowledge according to them is self-illuminating. The above table shows that according to Jainas, what takes place at the first moment of perception is an indeterminate awareness, which can be called seeing or darshana. After that, there is a kind of judgmental awareness, which can be called perceptual knowledge. Jainas understand perceptual knowledge as a process. The process occurs initially in four stages. Apprehension, that is avagraha, or it can also be called grasping. Then quest, iha, then determination, avaya, and retention, dharana. The first stage is called apprehension. At this stage, I cognize the object in its most general form. Suppose I am perceiving a table, then in the first stage, I do not cognize it as table, but I have only the cognition of the form, this is something. This is called apprehension or avagraha. Sometimes this avagraha is divided into two stages, apprehension of contact and apprehension of the object. Apprehension of contact is called vyanjanavagraha, apprehension of object is called arthavagraha. For example, suppose I am placing a toffee on my tongue. When I have, then I will have apprehension of the form something is in contact with my tongue. This is called Vyanjanavagraha, apprehension of contact. It will be followed by the next apprehension of the form, there is some taste. This is called Arthavagraha. Taste will be the object, and I am aware of the object of that cognition. So that will be called Arthavagraha, apprehension of the object. According to Jainas, these two stages of apprehension are not available in the case of all types of perception. For example, in the case of visual perception and mental perception, the apprehension of object is available, apprehension of contact is not available. So when I am perceiving through eyes, I am not aware that my eyes are in contact with the object, but I am aware of the object. So there is Arthavagraha, but no Vyanjanavagraha. Similarly, when I perceive something, that is, for example, I imagine something, I think about something through my mind, then also that my mind is in contact with the object, I am not aware of the contact between the mind and the object, but I am only aware of the object. That is because visual sense organ and manas give rise to their respective perceptual cognition without establishing contact with the object. This is the Jaina doctrine of aprapya karitva of the two sense organs. Whether sense organs cause the perceptual cognition by establishing contact with their respective objects or without establishing such a contact is an interesting issue in Indian epistemology. We will come back to it a little later. Let us now consider the second step in the process of perception, and that is Iha. The second step, that is quest or Iha. The literal meaning of the word Iha is desire, Ichha. It is the desire to know the object in particular. In the first stage, I had apprehension of the object in general. At the second stage, I tend to know it in its particularity. This is something, all right, but what kind of thing is it? There is some taste, all right, but what kind of taste is it? Jainas believe that implicitly or explicitly, such a quest or query does take place in our mind during the process of perception. Now the next stage is called determination, avaya. At this stage, I determine the object as table or as sweet taste. So I just have the cognition of a taste. Then what kind of taste is it? It is sweet taste. So I determine that taste to be sweet at the stage of what is called avaya. Similarly, I just perceive an object, but then I determine it to be table at the stage of avaya. In this way, the perceptual process, according to Jainas, starts with generality and proceeds towards determination of particularity. But this can be an ongoing process. That is because there are degrees of generality and particularity. For example, having identified the object as table, one can inquire into its more specific features. What kind of table is it? Round table, square, rectangular, wooden, plastic, metal. As Indrachandra Shastri says about Iha, as a matter of fact, Iha is a desire for knowing a thing in particularity. This particularity is not confined to a definite stage. Even after reaching a judgment or of a particular type, one can know further about its particulars. This desire to know occurs not only before determination, but also after it, if the cognizer continues thinking and is desirous to know a thing further. Then the fourth stage in perception is called retention, dharana. it comes after determination. In this stage, the judgment or determination which was made in the third stage is retained in the form of an impression which remains in the subconscious and is revived in the form of memory. The above explanation of the four stages of perception suggests that Jainas understood perception as a continuous and developing process. It is a process which proceeds from generality to particularity. Later on, we will see that it also continues thereafter through different types of indirect knowledge. So before we discuss in detail the Jaina classification of Paroksha Pramana, that is indirect knowledge, let us discuss a controversial issue regarding the availability of sense object contact, that is Prapyakaritva and Aprapyakaritva. We have seen that according to Jainism, the soul has power to cognize things without establishing contact with them. This capacity is actualized in the case of what can be called extrasensory perception, such as clairvoyance, telepathy, or omniscience. Jainas extend their no contact perspective of knowledge to ordinary perception also. There is a genuine problem about the possibility and nature of sense object contact and the way it shapes perceptual cognition. In Indian epistemology, this question was raised in terms of capacity of sense organ to cause perceptual cognition by attaining the object or without attaining the object, prapya karitva or aprapya karitva of indriyas. So I am translating prapti as attainment of the sense organ, attainment of the object by the sense organ. Nayayikas advocated causing by attaining, that is prapyakaritva thesis. They held that a sense organ can generate perceptual cognition only by attaining the object, that is by establishing a contact with the object. The next question was, how can the contact be established? In the case of three sense organs, the answer was easy. For example, skin, sense organ of touch, can cause the hot or cold sensation only by coming in direct contact with the hot or cold object. A tongue, sense organ of taste, can cause the sensation of sweet taste or bitter taste, whatever, by establishing a direct contact with the sweet or bitter object. The nose, sense organ of smell, can cause the smell experience through direct contact with the smelling object or smell particles. But the question arises with respect to ear, that is auditory sense organ, and eyes, visual sense organ. Suppose a drum is being beaten on the playground and we hear the sound in our house. Our auditory perception has the form, drum sound is being produced there, that is on the ground. When I see a star in the sky, I have the visual perception of the form, look, there is a star in the sky there. In both these perceptions, the sense object is remote from the senses. So the question is, how is the sense object contact established in these cases? There are two major difficulties in the Nyaya theory of hearing a sound. According to Nyaya, though a sound is produced, according to Nyaya, though a sound is produced due to interaction between material substances, conjunction among them, disjunction, friction, and so on, that is when drum is beaten, the sound is produced, that is sound can be produced only through some kind of interaction among material objects. Sound does not belong to but the sound itself does not belong to material substances, but according to them, it is a quality of akasha. Akasha is an all-pervading substance. This means that akasha exists even where there is no material substance. But we know that sound needs a material medium. It cannot exist in empty space. This is the first difficulty about the Nyaya conception of sound. The second difficulty is about the journey of the sound from the space, from the place of its production to the ears of the hearer. Sound is a quality. So according to Nyayika, sound is a quality. It is a guna. And according to Nyaya, the quality cannot move from one place to another. A substance can move if the substance is of limited size, then only it can move. If it is all pervasive, then it cannot move. And quality, guna, cannot have karma. In the technical terminology, only a dravya can have karma, guna cannot have karma. Guna cannot have guna, guna cannot have karma, and so on and so forth. So, sound is a quality, and according to Nyaya, a quality cannot move from one place to another. So when a sound is produced on the playground, how can sound itself move from that place to my ears? This is a problem. Sound is a quality of akasha, but akasha is an all-pervasive substance, and an all-pervasive substance cannot move from one place to another. So if akasha is supposed to be the medium of sound, then either sound should move or akasha should move, but both of them cannot move. So a sound cannot move neither by itself nor through its supporting substance, namely akasha. But it is a matter of our everyday experience that a sound is produced at a distant place and the listener experiences it in his or her ear. Nayayikas tried to explain this virtual motion of sound by using the metaphor of a wave. When a drum produces sound on the ground, it produces a larger circle of similar sounds. That circle produces a still larger circle, and so on. And so this is like a wave of water giving rise to a series of waves. Ultimately, the wave of sound produced in the area of our ear is heard by us. And that is how that is called Vichi Taranga Nyaya. So in terms of Vichi Taranga Nyaya, they explain the so-called passage of the sound from the place of its production to the ears. But wave is just a metaphor, because sound for Nayayikas is a quality and not a moving thing like a wave. Hence the Nyaya concept of Shabda as a quality of Akasha seems to be problematic. Jaina position seems to be better in this respect. In Jaina ontology, Shabda is regarded as material in nature, Paudgalika. It is regarded as a paryaya of Pudgala, mode of matter. Hence, the metaphor of wave can be applied to explain the passage of sound in a more satisfactory way in the case of Jainism. But even if sound is regarded as material in nature, a question remains. Our auditory perception is of the form, I am hearing a drum sound which is produced there now. But as a matter of fact, the drum sound was produced there a few moments back and not now. Similarly, the sound we hear, sorry, the spelling is incorrect, is not the drum sound, but the effect of the, or the effect of the effect of the effect of the drum sound. Hence, the so-called auditory perception is not direct cognition in the strict sense of the term. It involves a false projection of space and time. That is, sound was produced a few moments back there, not now, and it was produced there, but I am hearing it here, and it was produced there. So there is some kind of, some brain processes do take place, because of which I project it to be produced there now. The question is more serious in the case of visual perception. How can the contact be established between the visual sense organ and a distant object? The object does not leave its place and enter into your eyes. Nayayikas claimed that our visual sense organ, which is made of light, that is fire element, reaches the object, and this is how the sense of the contact is established. Nyaya solution is riddled with problems. Dignaga and other Buddhists criticized it vehemently. The modern mind will find the theory very difficult to appreciate. For instance, how can my visual sense organ establish contact with the star which is several light years away from me? My eyesight will take several years to reach the star and come back when I may not be alert or alive also. Today's science tells us that the star which I see in the sky with my naked eyes is actually not there at that time. The rays of light emitted by the star take several years to reach our eyes and create the visual sensation. Hence, like in the case of perception of sound, the element of false projection of the spatial location and time on the given object is involved in the perception of visual objects as well. This was generally not taken account of in the Indian theories of perception. The point relevant in the present context is that the Indian epistemologists were generally aware that there is some problem involved in explaining perception of an object remote from senses. Nayayikas were on the right track when they insisted that even in such a perception, the contact between sense and object is necessary. They went wrong in articulating the exact nature of the contact because the relevant scientific knowledge of the optics was not available. Buddhists and Jainas too realized the problem involved in explaining perception of an object remote from senses, but they went to the other extreme of no contact theory of perception. According to Jainas, no sense object contact is established in the case of visual and mental perception. Personally, I believe that no contact theory is not a solution to the problem of perception. With this brief discussion, let us turn to the Jaina theory of Paroksha Prama. Now, classification of Paroksha Prama. Siddhasena Divakara classified indirect knowledge into two types, inference and verbal testimony. So he gave the classification of Pramana into Pratyaksha and Paroksha was classified into Anumana and Agama. But Akalanka onwards, the Jaina philosophers accepted five types of indirect knowledge: recollection, that is Smriti, recognition, Pratyabhidnya, generalization, Tarka, inference, Anumana, verbal testimony, Agama. Let us briefly discuss the nature of these pramanas. Recollection or memory cognition, Smriti. Recollection or memory cognition is of the form that X. Indian philosophers distinguish between the uses of the pronoun this, that is idam, and that, tat. Present objects are referred to by the pronoun this, whereas temporally remote objects are referred to by the pronoun that. Recollection refers to a past object, hence it refers to it as that. So they would say Sahajina Dattaha. Jainas would give an example, that is Jinadatta, the name of a person whom I have seen before. So when I am referring to that Jinadatta, I will say Sahajina Dattaha. I will not say I am Jinadattaha. But when I am perceiving him, when he is in front of me, I will say, I am Jinadatta. So the use of the pronoun has implication to the nature of the cognition. Secondly, recollection is the cognition which arises from awakening of the impression generated by the past cognition. In this sense, it is a further continuation of retention, that is the last stage of perception. So while discussing perception, ordinary perception, we saw that Dharana is the last stage, retention. So when that Dharana is awakened, then we have recollection. So it is again a continuous process. In other words, it is a cognition of what is already cognized before. But should recollection be regarded as pramana at all? Other schools of philosophy are not inclined to give this status to recollection, mainly for two reasons. One, many schools hold that pramana should have novelty. It should be the cognition of something which is not already cognized. Recollection is the cognition of what is already cognized through perception or by some other pramana. So there can be recollection of what we have inferred, there can be recollection of what we have perceived, there can be recollection of what we have known through a scripture, but it always presupposes prior knowledge of the object. So that prior knowledge can be regarded as knowledge, but recollection cannot be called knowledge, it cannot be called pramana, according to many systems or most of the systems of Indian philosophy. Two, truth of a cognition is determined by the existence of the corresponding object. But truth of memory cognition is determined not by its correspondence with the object, but its correspondence with the experience which is revived through memory. Hence, there is a basic difference between memory and other cognitions in terms of their logical status. So, when we talk of, pramana is defined as that which corresponds to a real object. Now, suppose I have a dream experience, and then later on I record my dream experience. I say in dream I saw this, I saw that, so on and so forth. So, is this memory cognition, can it be called prama? Because what we have seen in dream are not real objects. So, that is the main difference between. So, in the case of recollection, I say that yes, your recollection is authentic, it is acceptable, but it does not correspond to real objects and therefore it cannot be called pramana. So, this will be the difference between other pramanas and recollection. In spite of such criticism, Jainism accepts recollection as pramana. Rather, Jainism is the only major school which does so. Jainas do try to answer the objections raised by the opponents. One, they try to show that recollection does have a novelty in a sense. It cognizes the object recognized before. It cognizes the object cognized before, but it does not cognize it exactly in the form in which it was cognized. For example, when an object say X was perceived, it was cognized as this X, but when it is remembered, it is cognized as that X. Two, though the truth of memory cognition is directly dependent on whether it correctly records the previous cognition, it indirectly depends on whether the object of that cognition really exists. But the main reason why Jainas recognize recollection as pramana is different. It is generally accepted by all the philosophical schools that recollection plays an important role in every type of indirect knowledge. Take inference, for example. Our inferential knowledge of fire on the mountain necessarily presupposes the recollection of the invariable concomitance between smoke and fire. So, we may remember that we have seen smoke and fire together before, and therefore there is fire. So, this recollection of smoke and fire together plays an important role in my inferential knowledge. And take the case of verbal testimony. The knowledge based on verbal testimony is possible only on the basis of the recollection of the conventional relation between words and meanings. Though all the philosophical schools recognize the role of recollection in indirect knowledge, they call the resultant indirect knowledge as pramana, but they do not regard recollection itself as knowledge or as pramana. This implies that a cognition which is not pramana gives rise to a cognition which is pramana. So Vyapti Smarana is not recognized as knowledge, but Vyapti Smarana is regarded as a necessary condition of Anumiti. So, but Vyapti Smarana itself is not given the status of knowledge. This is a problem according to Jainas. Jaina logicians think that this is a discrepancy. Jainas claim that if indirect knowledge, that is Paroksha Pramana, is to be understood as a result of a continuous cognitive process, then each cognitive episode occurring in this process should be of the nature of Pramana. Recollection is such a cognitive episode which occurs in the process of every type of indirect knowledge, every other type of indirect knowledge, that is, now later on we will see Pratyabhidnya, Tarka, Anumana, Agama, all these are different types of Paroksha Pramana, and Smriti is a necessary prerequisite of all of them. So Smriti also should be regarded as Pramana according to Jainas. Hence it must be accepted as Pramana. Now we come to the next Paroksha Pramana, that is Pratyavidnya, recognition. After recollection, Jainas accept recognition as Pramana. What is recognition? I have this type of cognition every now and then. I had met my friend Devendra Kulkarni 10 years back, and after a long interval, I recently saw him again. I recognized him. I had cognition of the form, this is the same Devendra as that which I had seen before. This is the same X as that. So this is the one of form of one of the types of Pratyavidnya, or we can say this is one of the standard forms of recognition. Let us analyze this cognition. The statement "this is the same X as that" expresses identity relation between this X and that X. This X is the object of perception and that X is the object of memory cognition. But the cognition of the identity between the two cannot be regarded either as perception or as memory cognition. This led Jainas to regard recognition as an independent form of cognition, form of knowledge, that is an independent pramana. However, Jainas did not restrict the scope of recognition to identity claims. They extended it to comparative knowledge claims of different kinds. For example, if I notice similarity or difference between the object of memory and the object of perception, then too it is a case of recognition according to Jainas. Hence, recognition can also have the following forms. This X is similar to yesterday's Y. This X is similar to that X, that is, may say yesterday's X. Now, analogy, that is Upamana, is also a kind of recognition. In the first talk, we considered analogy, that is Upamana, as Pramana accepted by Nayayikas. A city person goes to a jungle and sees an animal similar to cow, which he has seen before. On the basis of this similarity and on the basis of an expert's statement that Gavaya is similar to cow, the city person recognizes the animal called Gavaya. When he sees Gavaya, his cognition is of the form, this animal is similar to the cow I have seen before. Jainas claim that what they call knowledge from analogy is a kind of recognition. So hundreds of examples can be cited. Today's morning tea was stronger than yesterday's. You look smarter today. Whenever the objects of two different cognitions are compared, the comparative cognition is neither perception nor recollection, but recognition according to Jainas. I think Jainas are essentially right in pointing out that a comparative cognition of the above kind has to be given the status of an independent pramana. Other schools such as Nyaya and Mimamsa try to reduce recognition to a kind of perception. This is mainly because they want to adhere dogmatically to their traditional system of pramanas. Buddhists deny the authenticity of this so-called pramana because according to them, there cannot be identity of a thing over a period of time because everything is momentary. So when I say this is the same Devendra as the Devendra 10 years before, they will say that no, this is not the same. So it is a kind of illusion, a false cognition, and therefore it cannot be pramana. But as we have seen, the Jaina conception of recognition is not restricted to identity, but it covers other relations such as similarity and difference. The Buddhist criticism does not cover this aspect of Pratyavidya. Then we come to the next pramana, that is Tarka. The next important pramana is Tarka. The term literally means reasoning. The word Tarka, literal meaning of the word Tarka is reasoning. It was included in the list of 16 categories by Akshapada Gautama in Nyaya Sutra in the sense of hypothetical reasoning which leads to formation of a universal rule. This hypothetical reasoning often took the form of reductio ad absurdum type of reasoning. For example, in order to strengthen the invariable relation between smoke and fire, one may argue, if smoke were not invariably related to fire, it would arise without fire. Although Tarka in this way plays an important role in ascertainment of universal concomitants, Nayayikas did not give it the status of Pramana. So Nayayikas talked about what is called Vyaptik Grahaka Tarka, but that Tarka was hypothetical reasoning according to them, and any hypothetical reasoning cannot be regarded as Pramana, and therefore it was not included in Pramana, although Tarka was regarded as a kind of Aharya Jnana, that is a kind of artificial form of cognition, but it was not regarded as Pramana according to them. But ascertainment of universal concomitants was regarded as Pramana, but Tarka which leads to that was not regarded as Pramana. In fact, ascertainment of universal concomitants is an important issue in Indian epistemology. Those who accepted inference as Pramana had to accept the ascertainment of universal concomitants as a necessary precondition of inferential knowledge. Jainas successfully showed that the available pramanas, namely perception, inference or verbal testimony, cannot serve the purpose. So when Vyapti was accepted, the knowledge of Vyapti was accepted as a necessary condition of Anumana, then naturally the question arose by which pramana it can be known. So the available pramanas, namely Pratyaksha, Anumana, Shabda, etc., they cannot serve the purpose, and therefore Jainas thought that we have to accept a new pramana for that. A new pramana is needed, and Tarka, if it is interpreted as generalization, can be that pramana according to Jainas. There will be an occasion to discuss critically the question of ascertainment of universal concomitants when we discuss the Charvaka epistemology. Today we are trying to appreciate the Jaina approach to the issue. Jainas defined Tarka as the knowledge arising from observation and non-observation of the relation which exists in all the three times between the relata, that is terms of relation, such as the sign and the signified, Hetu and Sadhya. In this definition, observation means observation of the sign and the signified together, and non-observation means non-observation of the sign without the signified. So we have to observe many times Hetu and Sadhya together, and we should not observe Hetu without Sadhya. So that is observation and non-observation. The idea is that on the basis of repeated observation and non-observation, one makes a universal generalization pertaining to all places and times. Anywhere, anytime, if the sign is there, the signified must be there. If Hetu is there, Sadhya must be there. In other words, Tarka can be regarded as the knowledge based on inductive generalization. However, Jainas did not restrict the scope of Tarka to the knowledge of universal concomitants. They extended it to the knowledge of general rules. In general, universal concomitants is just one form of general rule. The other example of general rule they considered was word-object relation. Our linguistic practice is governed by certain general rules regarding word-object relation. The knowledge of such general rules is also subsumed under Tarka according to them. So that when we learn our language, suppose I use the word table many times for referring to this kind of object, and somebody who doesn't know the word table, he sees the behavior of me and many such people, then he may, on the basis of that, he will know that the word table means this kind of thing. So in this way, one learns the word object relation by through observation and non-observation. Although you cannot say that word-object relation is a kind of vyapti relation, because it is after all a conventional relation, and these conventions are made by human beings, and they are not made by God, or they are not natural relations among things and words. Therefore, it cannot be subsumed under vyapti relation. And therefore, they said that you can explain not only vyapti knowledge of vyapti relation by reference to tarka, but we can also explain the knowledge of conventional relation between words and objects through tarka. The rules concerning word object relation have a limited generality as compared to the generality of universal concomitants. Because universal concomitants is supposed to be a natural relation, whereas word-object relation is a man-made relation, and it will differ from language to language, of course. Secondly, these rules are not natural but conventional. They can change when the human convention changes. Moreover, they are restricted to a linguistic community. These rules change from language to language. For example, the verbal expression go means cow or bullock in Sanskrit. The same expression means to move in English. But although the